Hey VC, how's it going? Right, okay, we're back in the Vinyl Community Pub. I'm John, 6-inch penis 319. I'm once again joined by
Headley, another fat bearded man talking about records.
I do the same thing as every time. I do the same thing every time, Headley. So you got it by now.
Norman Maslov. I rarely say my full name, but aka Mazzy.
Yeah.
Short for Maslov. That's how it started in junior high school.
Well, welcome to the Vinyl Community Pub, Mazzy. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Very good.
Have you got a drink? What are you drinking,
Mazzy? I'm drinking an Italian soda because a week ago is when I first got COVID, and I'm alcohol free. First day of coffee this morning. So an Italian soda on ice. That's it. Unalcoholic.
Very sensible. Now, that's the problem, isn't it? You know, so I think the last one of these we did it with Digital Gramophone John. And unfortunately, I got to the Vinyl Community Pub about 5 hours before you two did. And you can tell in the video.
I thought that went really well, that one. I thought it was brilliant. The best you've ever been.
Yeah, cool. Right. Okay. So the premise of the video is that we're all in the pub and we've all got enough money for a round of drinks and we've all got a spare pound or a spare dollar to put in the jukebox. Now, with the rise of the cost of living, you no longer get three tunes. You only get two songs now for your buck. So Mazzy, so starting off with you. So what's your first pick?
Okay. My first pick is from 1967. And it's a song that explodes from my youth, from the summer of love, a reverb-drenched single that was one of the early psychedelic, early-ish mid-period psychedelic records that was recorded in a major studio in Hollywood when these professional engineers and producers really didn't know how to record rock and roll bands. They were all too loud and everything. But they made this single on RCA Records. And the lyrics, which I really didn't follow when I was a kid at all, I just loved the sound of the record. When the truth is found to be lies and all the joy within you dies, don't you want somebody to love? It opens up with this explosive Grace Slick, wow, that's Freudian. Grace Slick vocal, and then the music starts, and you listen to the music, it's all reverb drenched psychedelic guitars going off, but put back behind the lyrics, especially in the 45 mono version. And the mono is a different sound than the stereo. This song was written by Darby Slick, her husband or brother of her husband, that was when she was in the Great Society, the band prior to joining the Airplane, prior to a Surrealistic Pillow. But this sound, this single just explodes and it doesn't stop. And her voice is sexy. The band is great. Spencer Dryden's drums, I was disappointed when they pushed him out of the band. I think they wanted more of a rock sound when they got towards 1970. And he came from sort of a jazz background. But if you look at, listen to his drumming on Bless His Pony Little Head live album. It's so good. It's to me, they were the best of all the bands, but they burned brightly from 67, 68, 69, one of the greatest live bands in San Francisco. And then they kind of just splintered up with these side projects and they became a kind of a shite band at the time. And I guess whether you like the dead or not, they kind of took over, but never had a single, anything like this. So RCA Records, 45 RPM, 2 minutes, 54 seconds, produced by Rick Jarrett, a pure psychedelic pop bliss. Love it.
The thing about that
I'll definitely be staying in the pub if that goes on.
That's okay
with me.
Great song.
Although I have to admit, I think I've only ever heard the singles by Jefferson Airplane.
The thing is with that song in particular, I mean, it's a great sounding record, but it is all about her voice, isn't it? Her voice just sounds absolutely wonderful on that song.
You know, and this is the sister song, a lot of people will say is White Rabbit, another song she brought from her previous band. And on YouTube, if anyone hasn't heard it, listen to the voice version of that. There's a version on YouTube. that's just her vocal without any music of White Rabbit. Oh my, it'll drive you friggin' nuts. I mean, she was, every young boy I knew in San Francisco was in love with Grace Slick.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And she was like the older one. She was like 28, 29 when everyone else was in their early 20s at this point. So Grace Slick.
Cool.
Very cool. Yeah, good choice. Yeah, that'll definitely go down well in a pub, wouldn't it? Without doubt. Where you are there in Seattle, Mazzy, so are there many pubs with jukeboxes where you are, or is that sort of a thing of the past?
There aren't as many now. I think a lot of these bars, or whether they're the cool old funky bars or the hipster bars, either way, I don't think the bar owners want people to control the music.
Yeah, they want to curate it themselves, don't they?
So they'll have an iPod plugged into the thing. There are some that have record collections there, but they rarely played it. If you have a DJ later at peak nights, maybe. They have music piped in. They're pretty cool with their musical taste, depending on the kind of place. But the jukeboxes they're not a lot here. And we used to have, obviously, the big jukeboxes, whether it's a World Tour or the 50s Sebring, that were that 50s modern look. But also, in a lot of these diners had the ones that are at the counter. Remember those?
Yes.
The smaller ones?
Yeah, so them in the push. Films, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, we had those all the time when I was a kid in San Francisco.
It's an interesting thing, actually. I mean, we're going to ramble on, but it's an interesting thing to think about, the idea of these establishments that are literally going, right, we've set up the pub, you are going to bring the entertainment. You choose. The clientele chooses what goes on. You know, I mean, obviously they choose what goes in the jukebox. Well, no, actually, they probably don't, because they're probably some sort of, they were probably some company that would.
That's right. To fill it up with records. That's basically what happened, wasn't it? Yeah.
This is a cheat, a complete cheat, really. I don't think I'd ever find this in a jukebox, but in my world, this is in the jukebox, in the pub that I walk into. And it's Corner Shop. It's a double A side with Corner Shop and Blood Sausage. I'm not familiar with Blood Sausage, but Corner Shop doing a cover version of Jerry Reed, Guitar Man, that of course Elvis Presley. Made famous. Although, as they call it, I don't know if you can read it there, Sitar Man. Wow. So for those of you in the States, probably don't know Corner Shop. Corner Shop were a kind of an indie group. In fact, they were probably one of the most interesting bands to kind of be in the whole Britpop sort of era. They kind of straddled it. They started before it, and they kind of continue now. They're still going, aren't they? I think Corner Shop. But this is brilliant. So it's a cover version of the Elvis song, and just brilliant with sitar, and it's exactly what you imagine Corner Shop, if you're familiar with them, it would sound like. John, yeah, go on.
I would say, just with a sort of bit of background, obviously they're from Wolverhampton, which is obviously about 10 miles away from me here, and they're an Indian band, aren't they? So they're British, but with Indian heritage, and what they do is they bring that Indian heritage into British indie music.
Yeah, they often sing in Punjabi.
Yeah. So for example, the one thing that you'd appreciate, Mazzy, obviously been a Beatles fan, they do a version of Norwegian Wood, which is sung totally in Punjabi. And it's a great version. I mean, and this was on a hit album in the 90s over here.
Yeah.
They had the number one single with Brimful of Asher.
Two reasons why I really like Corner Shop. I should have more of their albums. I think I'm going to make a kind of a promise to myself to try and seek out more of their stuff. But two reasons I like them. One, I remember them being in the NME, burning a picture of Morrissey. So that gets them in my good book for one of them. And the second one is they had a number one hit single in the UK with a song called Brimful of Asher, which was remixed by Norman Cook, was Fat Boy Slim.
Yeah.
And it went to number one. And we need to thank it. It knocked Celine Dion with the My Heart Will Go On off number one. So
did it really?
They're the boys. Right. They really are. Yeah, they are. Yeah.
Fantastic. So,
yeah, that's great. I think we might add a needle drop, mightn't we?
So. You guys in the needle. God, that's Freudian. You guys in the UK don't like Celine Dion?
Well, I mean, I prefer that.
To me, I was never a fan, but Titanic totally destroyed any possible love for her. But that's personal. I mean,
you know, she has her place. You know, I'm a great believer in all music generally has its audience and its place. And I think to call something crap is generally that's not right. Unless it's played really poorly. And some, you know, that's crap music. But if it's well produced, it's well written, it's well, you know, it's just not for you. Admit that and don't call it crap.
Yeah. Well, I nearly about stopped to get down to Memphis. I ran out of money, you know. So I bought me a ride down to Macon, Georgia on an overloaded pension truck. I'm down down to Panama City to start kicking them all my balls. Hoping I could make myself a dollar making music on my guitar. I got the same old story from all my peers. There ain't no room around here for a sitar man. Sitar ni chai da jana. So I slept in the whole jungle. I rode 1,000 miles of track. Till I found myself in Mobile, Alabama. I had a good day called Big Jacks. I lit a four-piece band of jamming. So I took my sitar and I set in. I showed them what a band would sound like with a swing and a sitar man. Kala jamming.
Right, okay, so my choice. So this is obviously on the two-tone label, and this is the beat, or, you know, for yourself over there in America, it's the English beat, as they were known in the States. Yeah, okay. And this is their cover of Smokey Robinson's Tears of Clown.
Oh, that's a great song.
Yeah, so obviously the original Smokey Robinson and the Miracles came out in 67, I think, on their LP Make It Happen. And was then issued as a single in 1970, and it was a number one hit in the UK. I think it might have been a number one in the States, actually, maybe. But
I don't remember the charts, and it was all over MTV too. Also,
right.
No, so, what year was that?
Oh, so this is 1980. This would have come out in the States. This version. But I say Smokey's was a hit in 1970. Now the song the music is written by Stevie Wonder. The vocals are, obviously, the lyric is written by Smokey Robinson and the melody. And I was thinking about this the other day. Obviously, Lamont Dozier passed away a couple of weeks ago now. And, you know, I was thinking, I was playing a lot of Motown music. And the reason why Motown was so good was they had the best songwriters. That is the reason, you know, I know they had great artists, but without doubt, they had the best songwriters in the 1960s. Holland, Dozier, Holland, Ashford and Simpson, Smokey Robinson. The songs that they wrote during that 10-year period are absolutely incredible. And arguably, Tears of a Clown is perhaps one of the best songs from that period. And I would go as far to say, or this is the best compliment I can pay this version, is that it is easily as good as Smokey's original. I absolutely love this version. Obviously, the beat were from Birmingham, where I am here, part of the two-tone movement, which was very much a Coventry thing, which is about 20 miles away from where I am. But I say it did sort of bleed into other parts of the West Midlands. But this is an absolutely incredible record. Obviously, it's done in the ska style. I think played in a pub. This is an absolutely perfect Saturday night record. So, yeah, that would be my choice. Tears of a Clown by The Beat.
Good choice. Good one.
Now, actually, I didn't realise...
Sorry, one thing I'll just quickly say there is that last summer I went to a car boot sale. Now over here, I suppose similar to a flea market you'd have over there, Mazzy, you know, it's people just turn up, you know, with a car full of crap. They open up the boot, take it all out, and it's, you know, you just pick through it and buy whatever, you know. So
sure.
I was at a car boot sale, like, I don't know, 6 o'clock in the morning, and a guy turned up, got a table out, and he put out a load of T-shirts, records, CDs, and everything was by the beat, right? And I got chatting to him, and he basically... Wow.
Was it the lead singer?
Well, no, this is it. Obviously, Ranking Roger, the singer, died a couple of years ago, two or three years ago now. He passed away. And this guy basically said he was the manager of the beat. And obviously, after Roger died, that the stuff that was on sale, the merch table, you know, at the last lot of gigs, he still had all the stuff in his garage. And he just basically took it all to a car boot to knock out just for a few quid each. And I did buy some stuff off him. It was only on the way home. I thought to myself, I've either just bought a load of stuff from the manager of the beat, or I've just bought a load of stuff from a bloke who's robbed the lockup of the beat. You know, because so I'm not too sure which one it was, but he seemed pretty convincing. So, yeah. Yeah. So
I didn't realize. No, it's okay. I didn't realize Coventry or Coventry was so close to Birmingham, because I have been to Coventry, because we almost included that in her book, because that's where John Yoko did the Acorns at Coventry Cathedral. And whatever.
Yeah, they've got a Scar Museum. Have you been to it, John? Have you been to the Scar Museum?
I haven't, no. So it opened up a few years ago, 7 or 8 years ago. And I haven't actually been to it, no. It's in the centre of Coventry. And so, you know, the Ghost Town video, you know, they're all sitting in the car singing, you know, sort of driving around and singing. So it's basically half a car. It's the front of the car and some seats, basically. And that's in the museum. And you can sit in it and have your photograph taken. So you can pretend to be Terry Hall or Linville Golden or whoever, you know, and, you know, be in the Ghost Town video. I mean, that's pretty cool, isn't it?
Yes, that is cool.
Choice in the pub. I'm getting my last number. This goes back. Everything is about sense memory to me, all this stuff. 1970, I went with my confirmation class. That's when you're 15, 16, to Israel. And I'd never been to a disco ever, but before that, because you're a kid. And the discos were for adults in San Francisco or anywhere in the States. And so, but you'd go in these beach places in Israel, Netanya, and they'd have these discos that all ages are on at night out by the beach, you know, and one of the songs they kept playing that became a number one hit in the States. And this is by a Dutch group from The Hague. And it's one of the greatest singles ever. And of course it's called Venus.
Yeah.
This is such a great song. I heard that song throughout Israel, like for 2 months straight. And then, of course, when I got back, I bought the single. I can't remember exactly when it came out, but it was number one here. They were from the Netherlands movement, I guess they would call it, in the late 60s. And, you know, and they sang this in English. And actually, I have two of their later comps. I don't know if it's music on vinyl. And I didn't realize they're not just a one-hit wonder band. All their songs are really good, and I just never knew up until maybe 5 years ago. But I think this is great, and I even kind of love the version later on by Bananarama, or as you kids would say, Bananarama.
Bananarama, yeah.
But isn't that Bananarama? Isn't that what you guys say? Yeah. Bananarama? No,
yeah.
All right. This is It's just funny. I found I had also a reissue of it, which I had to look to see which one was the original. This is at least an original American one, or I think so. And it's the one I bought early on. And I just think this is a great song on the Jukebox. It's, again, I just realized there's a lot to be said about Venus sounds like the Jefferson Airplane with Gray Slick. They're very similar in style. And I just realized that I didn't pull these coincidentally for that reason. But I remember when Venus came out, some people thought it was the Jefferson Airplane. Yeah. Some people thought it was Gray Slick originally in the States, in San Francisco especially. So this just occurred to me in this moment here. So not Bananarama, but Shocking Blue from The Hague.
So Mazzy, the B-side to that is on that copy, is the B-side Hot Sand?
Yes.
Yeah, and that's a great tune as well. It's a great double-sider, perfect for a jukebox. Yeah,
wow, brilliant. I don't think I've ever listened. Yes. I have it on the album, so I got... Yeah, let me see. Is it on both of these?
Great. I remember, obviously, I heard the Bananarama version first, and there's always something lovely, actually, when you do find out that, you know, it's a cover version, and you go back and you get to hear, you know, the original version and a different version. It sounds, you know, but it's weird. It's familiar, but completely new. It's great.
It's such great, again, both those records start out and assault you with this great female intense vocal, I think. Love it. Love them both.
Yeah, fantastic. Headley, what you got, mate?
Okay, right. For my second 50p, whatever it is, because I did something that was probably a bit cheeky for the first choice that you wouldn't find in the jukebox, this is one I can guarantee you would have found in a jukebox, because in the town that I lived, called Moulton, which is in North Yorkshire, and there was a shop called Boys, and it was one of these shops that just sold everything. It was kind of a small department store. And one of the things they did when I was about sort of 14, 15, they had a spinner rack, which was full of ex-jukebox 7-inch singles. And they were all like sort of 59p each or whatever. And you go through and you try and find, and I've got so many actually, and I went through them. I decided that I was going to choose something that I picked up there in Boys, or as they say in Moulton, Boyses. I've been down Boyses. And I thought, and also John might be getting a bit itsy and doesn't like what I'm doing and what I'm playing. I know what he's like.
Yeah.
He'll start making comments.
Yeah.
So I thought I would Desmond Dekker and the Aces, Israelites.
Yeah. I almost picked that.
Well, Matt, I'm trying to think if John has actually already done, you haven't done this, have you?
No, I haven't done that.
So no, John knows because I have an original, but I also have the version that Stiff put out, the reissue.
Yeah, that's right.
This is 67, wasn't it? Wasn't it 67? Yeah. It was originally out.
We didn't even know that was reggae music when it came. It was a huge hit in America, and we didn't know what reggae was.
Yeah, well, it was the first reggae song here, wasn't it?
It was the first reggae number one in the UK. The first reggae number one in the UK. Yeah.
I don't think I knew it, even at the time, heard the term reggae until the 70s. Right.
That's right, yeah. It wouldn't have been called reggae then. So it's the first reggae number one. I think it was 1969 that it was a hit in the UK. But yeah, an absolutely wonderful song. You sent me a copy of that, Mazzy, in a box of records that you sent over. You had a US copy on the Uni label. On the Uni label, yeah.
Right.
But yeah,
right.
Wonderful song.
That's what Elton John was on Uni. Elton John was on Uni in this country.
Yeah.
Do you know, I had one of these weird moments with this. You know, they call it a Mandela moment. Sorry.
That's weird when you say that you're holding a big hole there and you just can have a weird moment. No,
hang on, hang on. Can I put the thing in to protect it? There we go. But no,
that's right.
You know, when you think you know something and you go, oh, I know what the B-side is. And like, for some reason, I thought that the B-side was 007, and it isn't at all. It's The Man by Beverly's All-Stars. And is that the producer, John? Do you know that? Is that who are the Beverly's? Do you know that?
Yeah, so it would be. So is that Leslie Kong? Leslie Kong, the producer, is it? Beverly's.
Well, right? I don't know, because the interesting thing is that the record is on Beverly's Bird Music.
Yeah.
So clearly it's connected to the production of it. Anyway, talking about the first time you heard these, I think the first time I heard this was, you probably remember this, John. There was an advert in the early 80s on the telly for a margarine, which was called Vitalite. And it was that get up in the morning, slaving for, what am I going to put on my bread? Vitalite. That's what it was. And that's so that was the Vitalite song. So I had to go and find it. So
yeah, that's not like Marmite.
John, you're happy with a bit of reggae. There you go.
Yeah, very
it's
good.
Not like Marmite, is it?
No, it's just a, you know, a butter spread. It's just a sunflower spread.
Get up in the morning, slaving for bread, sir. So that every mouth can be fed. Oh, me Israelite. Get up in the morning, slaving for bread, sir. So that every mouth can be fed. Oh, me Israelite. Oh, wipe on my kids, step back up and I leave. Darling, she said I was the ass to receive. Oh, me Israelite. Shut them a tear up choices ago. I don't want to end up like Bonnie and Clyde. Oh, me Israelite.
Right, okay, so I haven't got this track on 7-inch, so I'm going to hold up the album. So everybody likes David Bowie, right? So if you're in a pub of a Saturday night, you can't go wrong by putting David Bowie on the jukebox. And perhaps it's pretty obvious that my favourite period of David Bowie is the Young Americans period. Obviously being Blue Eyed Soul, or as he called it, Plastic Soul. And the title track, I would say, is possibly David Bowie's finest moment. It is an absolutely perfect piece of music. It's a straight soul record. It's got a real groove to it. You've got all those wonderful harmonies, those wonderful harmony arrangements by Luther Vandross.
But the he did that?
Sorry?
I didn't know he arranged the harmonies.
Yeah, yeah. So actually, one of the tracks on this album, I think the second track, third track, Fascination, is actually a ripoff of a Luther Vandross song, which David Bowie heard him play, and he basically reworked into Fascination. So yeah, but absolutely fantastic. I love, there's a clip of him on Soul Train, if you've ever seen it. And he looks scarily thin. You know, he's got his bright orange hair, you know, all sort of quiffed. And it's just an incredible performance. It's just him sort of vamping over the last part of that song. You got that groove going, and he's just vamping over the top. It's absolutely perfect. Now, I think playing that into on the jukebox on a Saturday night in a pub will go down an absolute treat. Now, one thing I will say, and this is something that my wife pointed out to me, is that whenever I put on a David Bowie song and I start singing along, I sort of start singing in a David Bowie voice. And I think it's pretty much impossible to sing along to a Bowie song without doing a crap impersonation of David Bowie when doing it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wasn't David Bowie the first white artist on Soul Train? Am I wrong about that?
Yeah, he could have been. Yeah, that's probably right.
Yeah. You're right, John. Sorry, Maz.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I know what you mean. There are some artists that you cannot sing their songs. I mean, you know, I like to play the guitar. I used to play pubs and things, and I could not do Billy Bragg's song because I'd end up trying to do his voice, and it's just awful.
Now, that's it. You can't sing along to Sexuality or A New England without trying to sound like Billy Bragg. And it's not done on purpose, is it? And I reckon it's the same with David Bowie. You automatically fall into a sort of a bit of a Bowie crap impersonation, you know, so.
I thought you were going to do it then, John. I thought you were going to do it for us.
No.
What's the Beatle connection with that song?
Well, John Lennon is he co-wrote Fame, and obviously there's
no, but that song, the song. Title song, what's the Beatles connection? I read the news
to A Day in the Life.
Oh boy,
yeah. There you go, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Failed the test, John.
There's always a Beatle connection, isn't there?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah.
We're gonna have a whip again. Round so we can get Muzzy another tune.
Whenever I don't know when you're gonna close this off, but when I had my first apartment with my buddy Brooks, Jazz Shit Brooks is known when I was in college, my very first apartment, we had this single, Gloria, and backed with the live version of My Generation by Patti Smith Group. The B side is a live version of them doing the Who Saw My Generation. And I don't know if I'm allowed to swear on your channel, but in the lyric, she says, "We don't need this effing shit talking about." That used to be our apartment theme song. So for a while in San Francisco, there were a couple of clubs that had this on the jukebox, and we'd always go play My Generation by Patti Smith from this. And I love that. And I love to, it kind of shocks people. Every time we have people over, but we put that on and blast it in our apartment, that B-side.
It's that thing, if people don't know, sometimes these B-sides can be a bit dodgy. You know,
absolutely, yeah.
And there are cases in the UK where actually, I'm thinking of a comedian called Jasper Carrot, and he did a routine that was about the Magic Roundabout, which was the kids' TV program. And it was all about that. And it was a stand-up routine, I think. And on the B-side, there was like a song. But actually, it wasn't. They did it as the A side because then everyone bought it for the comedy routine. But because that was rude. But they all then played on the television,
on the radio. Yeah. Funky Moped was the other side, wasn't it?
That was the Funky Moped.
Yeah. And the thing about the thing about Jasper Carrot, obviously he's got that sexy Brummy accent, hasn't he? So it's all delivered in that gorgeous.
I knew you'd know all about your that's right, your Homelander.
Has anyone done like a thread on that, like when the B side's better than the A side type thing?
It's a good idea, isn't it?
You know, it seems definitely like an obvious, and it seems like every once in a while there were songs that the DJ like turned it over and it became a hit, and the first one wasn't a hit, you know.
Maggie May,
Rod Stewart,
yeah.
Also, I think one of the songs Eva Destruction, you know, I think that originally was a B-side originally, and then they started playing that song. I don't think Barry, what's his name? Come on, Barry, you know the folk.
Barry.
No, it's not Barry.
Anyway, I don't think he loved that song. He didn't love that song. I have the album too, and I can see his close-up black and white face on that cover. Barry. Not Barry Lyndon, Barry. Anyway, someone's yelling it out right now.
Yeah.
Someone's yelling it out.
Have you got another record?
Wankers.
What?
Have you got another record? Mazzy's
got 50 cents.
I don't have any more money. I don't have any more. You never lend me any more money for the jukebox. So I don't.
I put a dollar in the play.
Do you want me to? I will. Oh, okay then. Okay. This one's for Mazzy. This one's for Mazzy.
Okay.
You'll like this one. This is Parlophone. This is Got to Get You Into My Life by Cliff Bennett and the Rebel Rousers, which is a great R&B version of it. Not that it isn't already, I suppose, an R&B song. But I've got this. And why have I got this, John? Do you know?
Because Chaz Hodges plays on it.
Yeah, Chaz Hodges plays bass on it. Yeah. That's why I've got it, yeah.
No, I can tell.
Great tune. I might even say, I think this is better than the Beatles version.
It was, is there, I like the Earth, Wind & Fire version actually too, yeah. Even though that, you know, that was the best thing that came out of that horrible film. But I have a question, you showing that record. Were there not most of the singles had the you know, that didn't have the big holes, they had that center thing? Was that not the case in the UK at some point?
That's been punched out. Has that been punched out?
Yeah, they would be, looks yeah, like, yeah. I've got one here. What's this? I've got one here. I know that, yeah, I've got one here that's got it. Yeah, they often they would be to be punched out, wouldn't they?
Oh, but I didn't know people punched out, because in America, we never had that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. It might have been in the Jukebox. I don't know. I mean, it's not. It didn't come with the cover. So
because the early drop down record 45 record players had that really RCA, that big thick spindle. You know, they dropped down. I have an old 45 record player downstairs that I don't use very often, but it's fun, and I have a stack of singles that are just stacked on it. I keep, you know, they've been there for 8 years now. The same five singles. Every once in a while, I turn it up. Takes about 3 minutes to warm up, and I play them and. Like I have Kicks by Polar and Narrators, and I have a few other things. And
right, that's it. Good stuff. Another good night in the Vinyl Community Pub. Some good songs.
Definitely.
There. Yeah. Mm. So cheers, Mazzy. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks.
Do you all have a local pub? Do you have a local pub near you that you go to regularly or not?
Yeah. So yeah, so mine's about a four minute walk from the house, you know, so I can get there
convenient.
Quite quickly.
That's
yeah.
convenient.
Yeah.
Mine's about a 2 minute walk. It's a wonder I'm not an alcoholic.
There you go. Yeah. So that's the thing about the UK, that there are pubs everywhere, you know, so yeah. you never.
Oh, yeah. Thanks for having me. Yeah. I was in Liverpool and we went to a pub one afternoon. We were driving around, we were doing our book and we wanted coffee. Americans want a coffee in the afternoon. We don't want friggin' tea. And we there's this one pub had a horse outside and it said something pub cafe, whatever. We go in and we ask for coffee and the guy looks at us like we're communists and says, we don't have coffee here. He goes, and I think I said, but it said coffee outside or cafe outside. He goes, there's a horse outside there. You don't hear see any horses here, do you? You know, with a Liverpudlian accent, which I won't try. So
yeah.
Well, John will do it for us.
No, it just sounds like David Bowie, you know.
And Headley would sound like Billy Bragg. So.
Yeah, that's right. Cool. All right, then.
Thank you.
Well, cheers, everyone.
Cool.
Take care.